We have a short video of the history of the church that we would like to share with you, and you will see the handiwork of God. God gets all the credit. God gives all the glory for this, and we want to show this as a testament to how God has been so good to us. As soon as we opened the church as a ministry, God gave us a building within 2 months, and isn't that miraculous? Many churches don't have a building for 10 years, and we had one within 2 months. And then every point there on after, God just kept adding and adding and blessing and blessing, and we're so excited. I want to be a part of a church that's doing something. Amen. Amen, don't you? I want to be a part of a church that has a vision to grow and to build and impact our community for Jesus Christ. Amen. Glory to God. So if we could bring the lights down and let's look at the testimony of God's goodness.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Hasn't God been good? Isn't that a wonderful testimony of the goodness of God? We've had a rich 11 years of experience, the presence and the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and God gets all the glory. Ray Michael, I think in every slide that I looked at, I saw your fingerprints on them because you've done all the sound, all the lighting, so many projects in this place. Ray Michael is one of the founding members of this church. Give the Lord a shout of praise for Ray and Barbara Michael. Praise the Lord. Amen and amen. Media Solutions, and they travel all over the country doing church installations and whatnot. They're awesome. Praise the Lord. We are so very blessed today to have one of our board members of the church with us, to have the dean of Kingsgate College with us today, to have someone that's ministered in over 50 countries on the planet today, to have one of our close personal friends, to have someone that's been hooked up with Grandview Church since our very beginning. He and Bishop Tony ministered here early in our ministry as a church, and have been a voice into this house forever. Dr. J. Pike, did you earn your doctorate a year ago now? Is it a year ago, 2 years ago? He's a graduate of Oral Roberts University, as I am. And he is a guy, the thing that I appreciate so much with Dr. J is that he is such a forward thinker, as is all of the core team in Destiny Fellowship of Churches. We are hooked up with a dynamic international ministry. Praise the Lord for that. But Dr. J has his finger on the pulse of what's happening in the body of Christ in the earth today. He is always looking to take the church forward. Church, we can't get stuck. We cannot get stuck in doing it the same old, same old, same old way. You don't change the message, but the methodology needs to keep pace with where Jesus is going. God is on the move, I'm here to tell you. God is on the move. So we were absolutely delighted that Dr. Jake had time in his schedule to come be with us today. I want you to stand with me as we help to welcome the man of God to the pulpit in Grandview Church on this celebratory service, Dr. J. Pike. Thank you, my brother. Thank you for being here.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We love you. Before you're seated, I just want to ask you, I really feel like that we're in a to God be the glory moment. And so before we're seated, with just taking that video in, taking the story in, all that it means, all the transformed lives, all of God's faithfulness, think about all the things that God has been to you as a church family. Then think about yourself personally. Think about all the goodness of God that you've experienced. Hold on, just think about it a little bit more. Think about where you would be if it hadn't been for Jesus. Think about all those things, and let's give God a to God be the glory praise right now. Come on. Come on, that's not all you got. To God be the glory. We thank you, Jesus. We give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise. Amen, amen, amen. You can be seated. Amen. What an absolute joy and delight for me to be back at Grandview and to be a part. Like Pastor said, it's a real honor for me, not just to be a guest minister, but to be a part of your family. And I count that a real honor, and I'm not able to serve all the churches that I preach in the way that I'm able to serve here, and so that's a special thing. I do that when God assigns that to me. Amen. And so it's a real honor. And I'm serving in more and more of those roles in my life right now. But I know that there are some churches that God has connected me with, and this is one of them. And they're special. And so every time I'm here, I feel like that long lost relative, that crazy uncle that only comes, you know, every other Thanksgiving, and you have to put up with him for one weekend. Amen. And so if you're thinking right now, my family doesn't have a crazy uncle, that's probably because you're the crazy uncle. And so, you know, when you show up, everybody says there's a crazy uncle, and you don't think there is one. But I am delighted and honored to be here today. It's your birthday, Grandview. Or it's your birthday celebration. We're celebrating near your birthday. And what an amazing, just loved that video. That just blessed me. And it's amazing to think, and I'm going to preach in just a minute, and some of what I feel like God's put in my heart for you will allude to this, but I just want to make this point really clear, because sometimes we can lose sight of the significance of what's happening or a moment. And, you know, I was watching that video, and I just thought, you know, you really need to think, you know, of what it's like from God's perspective, you know, to look down at, like a proud parent, you know. Because, see, for God, 11 years ago, he had a baby, right? He had a little baby called Grandview Church. And in order for God to have a baby, we're going to look at this in our message, but he had a little baby. He's always got to find a willing womb in order for God to have a baby. And so we're grateful that God found a willing womb, and he had a little baby. But I just think, like, you know how proud parents are, and I just think that, like, God must look down and he just get everybody's attention and just say, look at how my baby's doing, you know? Look how there's people from every culture. Look how there's people from every generation. Look how there's people that come from all different backgrounds. Look how they're breaking down barriers. Look how they're bringing the kingdom of heaven to earth in Florida. Just look at them. They're just making me proud. Look at their sacrificial giving. Look at them living in the ways of the kingdom. Look at them just worshiping with all of their heart. And I just want you to know, I believe God's proud of you today, Grandview. Amen. He's proud of you. And so we give glory to God for his goodness to us. And I want to give honor today to the people, because if you can't figure it out, like if you want to know a real shocking truth, you know, this is 11 years for Grandview. And that means that 12 years ago, there was no Grandview. And so this is how God works. When there is nothing and God wants something, God says, let there be. So, sometime before 11 years ago, God said, let there be Grandview, right? But how many of you know that when God says, let there be, there always has to be somebody who has ears to hear what God is saying? And then this is what I want to preach about, but before I do, so we have to have somebody who says, let it be done unto me according to your word, right? And so we want to give honor today to so many people who served and gave and blessed and made this possible. But there's a couple who heard that let there be more than 11 years ago. And they said, God, we're willing. We see the vision. We hear your voice. And you can birth it. We'll be the first ones to have faith and take steps of obedience to make it happen. And God always needs that. And so we wouldn't be here without God. And we wouldn't be here without the faith and the obedience of our founding pastors, Pastors Jamie and Debbie Watts. So we give you honor today. We thank God for you. Wouldn't be here, amen, without your faith and your obedience. Amen. 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 Yeah. Yeah. So my wife sends her love, and our church in Oklahoma City My wife was planning to come with me. She loves to come to Grandview. It's one of her favorite places to come. Don't tell the other places I preach, but Cece loves you, and you love Cece, and she was planning to come, but my daughter is just a little bit older than Grandview, and she had a basketball game and some things going on this weekend, so Cece decided to stay home with her, so she sends her love, but we celebrate your birthday with you, and excited to be able to share with you. I want to just open up God's Word and just share what's in my heart for you. Are you ready for the Word? If you'll grab your Bibles, I want you to turn in a couple of different places. I've already alluded to some of them in Luke chapter 1. We'll begin in Luke chapter 1. We'll be in Luke 1. We'll be in Luke 2. And we'll be in Ephesians 3. And so we'll read these verses. They're short verses. And it'll get us where we're at least it'll get us moving in the direction that we want to go. Amen. Luke chapter 1 and verse number 38. Luke 1, 38. Then we'll be in Luke 2, 19. And we'll be in Ephesians 3, 20. Luke 1, 38. Then Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be done unto me according to your word." Let it be done unto me according to your word. Luke 2:19, but Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Luke 2:19, but Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. We'll refer to that in just a little bit. And then a very familiar verse in Ephesians chapter 3, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond. So everybody, would you just say that word beyond? Just say beyond. Exceedingly abundantly beyond all we could ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. So here's the title of my message this morning, Grandview. I believe that God is saying to us, it's time to go beyond. It's time to go beyond. Why don't you just look at your neighbor and look him in the eye and say it like you mean it. Say, it's time to go beyond. Yeah, that feels good. It's time to go beyond. It's time to go beyond. Holy Spirit, we ask you to speak to us in this place, in this moment. God, this is a divine moment. It's a time of reflection and demarcation. But Lord, we're asking for it to be a time of revelation, because you are not the God only of the past, but you are the God of the future, and you are the God of the present. So Lord, we know that you have a future for us, but more importantly, we know that you have a present word for us. So we want to hear the word that you're speaking so we can enter into the future that you've prepared for us. So open our ears and let us hear what the Spirit is saying to Grandview Church this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Mary in the Gospel of Luke is an important figure, and that should not be difficult to understand. It is Mary who... the Virgin Mary, who makes herself available to God, is chosen by God and becomes the mother of Jesus. You know this. And so while we are not of a tradition, and sometimes Protestants can be nervous if you talk about Mary, we don't need to be nervous about talking about Mary. How many of you know Mary can teach us some things about the kingdom? And so we're going to look to Mary a little bit to teach us some things about kingdom and God's purposes. But Mary helps us make some important shifts in our life. I spent some time yesterday with some of the leaders and the pastors of Grandview. And one of the things that I believe that the Lord is speaking to the church is in this moment of disruption and in this moment, this season where things have been disrupted and delayed. How many of you know any time you get something that takes you off guard. You ought to tune yourself to what God's doing at a higher level. One of the things that you have to learn is that when life throws you a curveball, what happens is that causes it robs people of many divine opportunities is that when life throws us a curveball, it just throws us completely off track and we lose touch with God and we go into survival mode. But one of the things that you'll learn as you mature in the kingdom of God is that when life throws me things I didn't see coming, then that's a sign, that's a signifier that God is up to something I wasn't expecting. So a mature follower of Jesus, when surprises and disruptions and things we didn't see coming are thrown our way, it doesn't take our awareness down, it takes our awareness up. So you might find a mature follower of Jesus who looks like they've been knocked off their feet and they're a little bit confused and disoriented. But if they're a mature follower of Jesus, you can't judge them by first sight. Because when you find them knocked off their feet, they'll be in the place of prayer trying to discern and discover God must be up to something in the middle of this. I didn't see this coming, but I know God. And when I don't see things coming, how many of you know just because you didn't see it coming doesn't mean God didn't see it coming? How many of you know that just because it knocked you off your feet, it didn't knock God off his feet? Just because you weren't expecting this season of disruption and delay, it doesn't mean that God sent it. It doesn't mean that God did it, but it does mean that God wasn't taken off guard by it. And sometimes God tells you to turn left when you think you were going to turn right. And in those moments, if we can learn how to follow God, we'll discover treasures and riches. We'll open up new pathways to purpose. We'll step into greater realms of fruitfulness and understanding. But we've got to learn how to train ourselves to pay attention to God in the disorienting seasons. What if I said it to you this way? How many of you know sometimes when you get disoriented or disrupted, how many of you know it's not a pleasant place? I don't know if you're like me or not, but I kind of like to know what's going on. I not only like to know what's going on, I like to know what's getting ready to go on. I like to have it all figured out, and then I just predict it, and then I see it coming, and then I respond to it. I'd really like to have about 3 weeks' notice. If you could give me that, that would be even better. How many of you know that's the truth? But how many of you realize that when we get disrupted, when we get disoriented, when we get knocked out of balance, that's a good way to think about that. So when you get knocked off balance, what if it can feel like a confusing place, can't it? Let's just be honest. Can we be honest in church this morning? Can feel like a confusing place. There's lots of different words. So there's a process that we go through, right? And that is a process of owning the fact that I really don't know what's going on. And it might be, I just want to suggest to you this morning, that it might be that God's dilemma in getting you in on what he's doing, God has a dilemma. See, he wants to get you in on what he's really up to, but as long as you think you know what he's up to, then you can't get your eyes open to see what he's really up to. So in this moment, God has a dilemma. And so the dilemma is, as long as they're so confident about what they're doing, where they're going, and when they're going to get there, and what it's going to look like, I'm going to need to let something come in and just throw them off balance. I don't want to destroy them. I don't want to knock them completely off, but I want to get them enough off balance that they start asking questions. And I want you to know that when if you're in a season where you're asking more questions than you have more answers, then that's not a bad thing. That's a good thing. That means you're more open to God showing you some things you haven't seen before. See, the Holy Spirit spoke it to me this way. You remember in Proverbs chapter 19 and verse number 21, it says, many are the plans in a man's heart. Many are the plans. Look at your neighbor and say, according to the Bible, it looks like you got many plans. Yeah, many are the plans, right? You got plans to go to college. You got plans to get a job. You got plans to buy a house. You got plans to buy a car. You got plans to retire. You got plans to have kids and grandkids. You got plans to have a dog. You got plans to do all kinds of things. Somebody looked at me and said, no, I ain't got no plans for no dog. Don't you put that on me. I said, not in my house. No, sir. I just got rebuked over there. I'm not going to tell you who it was. I'm not going to tell you who it was, but they resisted that word. Amen. How many of you know we got many plans? Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. Now, I saw one of our mandates is to help people discover their purpose. Is that right? To develop their purpose. And so here's the thing. You've got many plans, but God has a purpose. And so another way to say what I'm trying to say to you is that it could be, if we get up in God's seat with God's perspective, it could be that our many plans are obscuring our view of God's purpose. I'm going to say that again, because this side over here, only three of them got it. Amen. I said it could be that our many plans are obscuring our view of God's purpose. So if that's ever the case, Pastor, I've been thinking about this, and what I realize is that what God needs to do, because God so wants us to have a revelation of His purpose. And so if my many plans are obscuring my view of God's purpose, then what God needs to do is He needs to let my plans unravel so His purpose can be revealed. Now, I'm preaching better than you're shouting this morning. I said, sometimes God needs to let your plans unravel so that His purpose can be revealed. So that means that you will find that real mature kingdom believers, people that have been walking with Jesus and taking Him seriously, they're paradoxical. They don't always make sense. Because when you find people like this, their plans may be unraveling, but they'll be full of joy and expectancy even though their plans are unraveling. And you might come up to them and say, well, I thought you were planning to be here by Noah. That didn't work out. And they got a big smile on their face. And you look at your husband or your wife and you say, what's wrong with them? They're playing because they understand, yeah, my plans are unraveling, but somewhere in the midst of this season, God is revealing His greater purpose. God is up to something good in this moment of my life. There are those Psalm 23 Christians that say, He leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, how you doing? How's your season? I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death. Are you depressed? I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. I'm walking through a dark place. I'm walking through a disorienting place. I don't have the plans. I don't have it all figured out. I don't understand what's going on. But the one thing that keeps me going is that He is with me in the middle. As long as He's with me, I'm going to be all right. How many of you know if your plans are unraveling, if your plans are dying, then you don't need to be afraid. Because whatever it is that was born of the Spirit will never die. So you just need to say, well, if that was from God, it may look dead, but it's going to come back to life. And if it doesn't come back to life, then it was my plan, but it wasn't His purpose. I don't live for my plans. I live for God's purpose. I realize I come to the bedrock foundation of my faith is a trust in the fact that God's purpose is greater than my plans. Amen. I try to make plans. I believe in plans. I always try to make plans according to God's purpose. But how many of you know I don't always get it right? And sometimes my plans are blocking my view of God's purpose. And so Mary demonstrates this shift that's taking place in this moment broadly for the body of Christ. And that is a shift from what I want to say. Many people have a transactional relationship with God. A transactional relationship with God. You say, what do you mean by that? I mean that prayer is transactional for people and only transactional. I mean that their relationship with God, their understanding of who God is and what He does in their life is purely transactional. There are transactional aspects to how our relationship with God works, how prayer works. We ask God, give us this day our daily bread, right? How many of you know that, how many of you are grateful that if you ask God for things, He gives them to you? The Bible even tells you that sometimes you don't have anything because you're not asking. So it's okay to ask God for things. But what I'm concerned about in many Christians' lives is that our prayer life, our relationship with God, is exclusively transactional. When God's ultimate purpose, see, transaction has to do with your plans. But if you want to know what God's up to with His purpose, it's never purely about transaction. It's always about transformation. Yeah, thank you. I got one in the back there. Somebody woke up. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Are you with me? So how many of you know that my plans have to do with God? I need I don't know if I'm going to be able to make my car payment. You know, I need a new this. I need a new that. I need help here. You know, maybe they're even good things. More important than a car payment. I want to see my kids saved. I want to see things happen right. I want to see good things happen for my family. But how many of you know in the midst of all those plans and things that I'm bringing to God, God is ultimately, His purpose revolves around transformation. So Mary illustrates us a way of praying that shifts us out of transactional praying only and into formational praying or transformational praying. So I want you to look at Mary and her prayer, and I want you to start to incorporate that kind of prayer into your prayer life. I'm trying to position you for beyond. You see, I'm trying to get Grandview Church and everyone who's connected to it. What my goal is today, I'll know that I have succeeded. I'll know that we've got a win. If after today you're positioned a little bit differently in your mindset and in your prayer life so that you're beginning to say things like this, God, whatever you're up to, whatever your purpose is, I'm praying that you'd let it be done unto me. I'm praying that you'd make room for it on the inside of me. I'm not really worried about me and my bills and my plans and my future, but what I want to know is, God, who are you calling me to become? Who are you making me into? Who would you like me to be on mission to? How can I serve this generation for you? And all of a sudden, our prayers get synced up with God's purpose, and transformation begins to break out. This is a shift from consumer Christianity to kingdom Christianity. It's a shift from cultural Christianity to authentic Christianity. It's a shift from transactional prayer to formational prayer. Now, let me help you quickly with your understanding of prayer. You guys are making me preach too slow. She's like, you're preaching slow. Here's one of the indicators that we've missed something in terms of prayer. See, a lot of times we think that prayer is what I do. I pray so that I can get God to do what I think God ought to do. Amen. Somebody, at least I don't have to convince you of that. Everybody believes that. That's good. At least I think I'm hitting a nerve right now. I feel like a doctor. I just hit a nerve. Amen. How many of you know that fasting? Sometimes we think that, well, you know, I'm really needing this to happen, and I've been praying about it, and then somebody will say to him, well, you need to fast, because apparently, you know, prayer is not pulling the lever with God, so if you fast a little bit, maybe it'll convince God to do what God's already, you know, are you with me? It's like we're trying to talk God into, but how many of you know there's something about that don't feel right now? Are you with me? We're missing something here. Right? We're in the arena, but so here, let me give you a better way of understanding that. See, God does not need any convincing. That's what you got to understand. See, this reveals a poverty mindset in our understanding of who God is and what He is like. And so the first thing you need to understand is that God delights in blessing you. You don't need to convince God or persuade God or talk God into anything. In fact, the only thing God does is bless and heal and save and restore and redeem and make better and take from glory to glory. So if you can understand your prayer this way, that God is in heaven and he's doing what he does. Goodness and mercy are flowing from him. God is a provider. God is a healer. God is a deliverer. God is a restorer. So when I pray, I don't talk God into doing any of those things. Prayer doesn't change God. Prayer changes me. So what happens is I get in my life and I get bent all out of sort and I get mispositioned in life and my soul gets closed down. And so God's pouring out everything God wants to pour out, but it isn't getting to my heart. It's not getting to my address. It's not getting into my life. And I don't know, it might be because I'm on Facebook more than I am in my prayer closet. It might be that I'm on Fox News more than I am in my prayer closet. I don't know what may be the reason for that, but what prayer does is prayer brings me around and it repositions me so that now I'm positioned and ready to receive and hear what's flowing from the throne of God. See, the primary purpose of prayer is not to get God to do what I think God ought to do. The primary purpose of prayer is for me to be properly formed. Amen, amen, amen. Are you with me this morning? So this prayer that Mary prays is a formational prayer. And the reason I'm interested in Mary is because Mary shows us something, that what's happening is that God is allowing Mary to participate with God. You see, and that's something that we need to start thinking about all of our lives, that this is what God's. In fact, I like to say it to you this way. A friend of mine, Dr. Darius Daniels, says it this way. He says, you know, salvation is your invitation into participation with God for the reason for your creation. I'm going to say that again. Salvation is your invitation into participation with God for the reason of your creation. In other words, at some point in your adult life, you probably ought to slow down long enough to go, you know, what in the world am I here for? Right? And then you understand that salvation is God saying to you, hey, I had a reason for creating you, and I would love for you to participate with me in my reason for your creation. In other words, I want you to become who I called you and created you to be so that together we can see my purpose come forth in your life and in your family. Am I doing all right? So Mary has this encounter and she realizes I was created for this purpose. Now watch this. Just because she was created for it doesn't mean she was qualified for it. See, I got to help somebody right now, because that was Mary's first objection, is that the angel said to Mary, he said, you were created for this. God has this in mind for you. And Mary says, nope, you got the wrong gal. Wrong gal, because I'm not qualified for that. And the angel says, oh, no, you don't understand how God works, because God doesn't call the qualified, God qualifies the called. God doesn't do it that way. God doesn't send you to school and make sure you get straight A's and then say, okay, we're going to hire you for the job. Here's what God does. God says, I'm going to choose you before you've proven yourself and qualified yourself. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to get down on the inside of you and I'm going to transform you so that you are now a new creation and all of your old disqualifications fall off of you and you become a testimony to the grace and the glory of God. See, when you start stepping into your purpose, you ought to have people who are mysteriously astounded at how in the world you're doing what you're doing.
You see, if you could go back about 30 years in my life and find some old friends of mine and you brought them into church, they would be sitting in the pew saying, "That's Jay that I went to school with. Y'all don't know the Jay that I know," right? And they would be totally perplexed because I'm not qualified to be participating in God's purpose for my life. But I opened my heart to receive His grace, His transforming power. And then you start doing stuff you're not qualified for. Mary, in the New Testament, in Luke and John, they're alluding back to Genesis. And so Mary is the new Eve. You see, Eve in the Garden of Eden, when God said, "I want you and Adam to participate with me in my purpose of blessing and subduing and being fruitful and multiply," Mary kind of went along with that. But then the next thing we hear Mary saying is she's saying, "Did God really say?" And you realize that Mary was called, her name was the mother of the living, right? But Mary doesn't become the mother of the living, she becomes the mother of the dead, actually, right? So she gives birth to Cain and Abel, and immediately death is visited upon humans because we've introduced sin and death into the world. So Eve is called to be the mother of the living, but Mary comes along as the fulfillment of the prophecy over Eve that the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. And so Mary now stands in a place of virginity and innocence. She stands in a new Garden of Eden. And when God says, "I want you to participate with me in my purpose," Mary doesn't say, "Did God really say that?" She says, "Let it be done unto me." You see, Grandview, I've got a prophetic word for you, that God is so proud of these 11 years. He's so excited. You're excited. He's excited. But I got a question for you. The question is, you stand on the precipice of this 11-year pinnacle and you look to the future, is, are you going to be an Eve or are you going to be a Mary? Are you going to begin to say, "Did God say?" Or are you going to be saying, "Lord, let it be done unto us again according to your word. Give us another 11 years. Give us another 15 years. Give us another generation of fruitfulness in your name." And so it's this return to innocence. It's this return to let it be done. It's this return to childlike faith that keeps us fresh, that keeps us supple, that keeps us moldable, that keeps us a willing womb. Because see, I've got news for you. If you've been through one cycle of fruitfulness in your life, congratulations. If you've received one word from God or 14 words from God and seen them come to fulfillment, congratulations. But I got some news for you. I don't care how old you are. I don't care what season of life you're in. God is not out of revelation. He's not out of power. He's not out of ability. He's got more for you to do. Amen. Amen. And so God's purpose moves us beyond. I want to take just a moment and lean in on this word beyond. Are you doing all right this morning? So beyond. Now, Ecclesiastes tells us that to everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. So what Ecclesiastes 3:1 is telling us is that any time we enter into a new season, right? Now, I don't know where you're at in life, but I don't have to be very prophetic. Most people around this time, this moment, this is the fall of 2021. Unless you've been sleeping under a rock for the last 2 years, then there's a sense in which all of us are kind of stepping into a new season. And most people I know are pretty happy about the new season. We're kind of tired of the old season. Amen. Some of you want to keep on living in the old season. Just knock yourself out. That's all right. Are you with me? So, I'm not making any, don't misunderstand me there. So when you come, here's the kingdom principle. When you come into a new season, Pastor, right? If you come into a new season, and according to Ecclesiastes 3:1, then when you get into a new season, then there's going to be a new purpose. That's what, I'm just reading the Bible. I'm just reading the verse. Just reading the text. To every season, there's a purpose, right? So that means if I get in a new season, then I got a new purpose. Now, how many of you know that the purpose of God has to be revealed? It has to be discovered. You don't determine the purpose of God. You discover it. Are you with me? And that's why Mary's kind of formational prayer becomes so important to us as we enter into new seasons. So Paul is writing the church in Ephesus, and he says to them, I'm talking to you about God's purpose. And he says, I want you to understand that God's purpose is always exceedingly abundantly beyond all you could ask or think, or some translations say imagine. I love that, because you can't even imagine what God's purpose is. You couldn't even, if you went to dreaming it up like Walt Disney, you wouldn't be able to imagine it. Are you with me? Right? So he says it's beyond. So watch this. How many of you know that if it's not beyond my ability to ask or think, then it's probably just my plans? Because my plans are within the realm of my ability to ask, think, and imagine, right? So if what I'm praying is within the realm of my ability to ask, think, or imagine, then, you know, they could be good plans. They could be godly plans. They could be plans that, you know, really want to do good things. But I haven't completely tapped into God's purpose, because if I tap into God's purpose, it's going to be beyond. Now, let me share with you just quickly, and I want to prophetically speak these into this moment of Grandview Church, because God's getting ready to thrust you further beyond than you've even imagined. Amen. Amen. All right. So what God's bringing about within us, here's some things, you can write them down. It's beyond our understanding. It is beyond our culture. It is beyond our expectations. It is beyond our comfort zones. And it's beyond anything we can ask, think, or imagine. Now, let me say something to you that the Holy Spirit spoke to me, and it's a little strong. That's why I'm telling you the Holy Spirit said it, so you don't get mad at me. You get mad at Him, okay? You ready for this? If what you're doing hasn't moved you beyond your culture or your comfort, then you might be doing something religious, but you haven't yet tapped into God's purpose. That's not how I responded when He said it to me. I kind of said, ouch. Because watch this. See, it's possible. I'm going to say it to you one more time. Some of you are looking at me like, say that again. If what you're doing hasn't moved you beyond your culture or your comfort, then you might be doing something religious, but you haven't yet tapped into God's purpose. You see, the Pharisees were doing religious stuff. But you know what they were doing it with? Their little circle that fit in their comfort, their culture, and their understanding. And they had conflict with Jesus because they kept saying, well, we're doing it according to the book. And we're doing it according. And Jesus said, yeah, I know. You're doing religious stuff. Don't get me wrong. Some of it you're doing is right. But the problem is you haven't tapped into God's purpose, because when you tap into God's purpose, you'll always look like this. Whoa, 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 whoa. That's a little further than I wanted to go. You see, the Pharisees were like, we got this figured out. We got our people. We know where we're comfortable. We know how God works. We got it all figured out. And Jesus was out there with tax collectors and prostitutes and different people from different places. And the Pharisees kept going, we don't understand that. We can't figure that out. I'm uncomfortable over there. And Jesus says, that's right, because I'm in God's purpose, and God's purpose is always moving us beyond. Are you with me? So here I'm gonna try to break things up, and I'm getting close to being done. Amen. We got to cut some ribbons. And everybody doing all right? Yeah. Pastor Debbie told me to keep preaching, so you can take it up with her next week, all right? I want you to, and I believe this is really going to help some people. So when we talk about God's purpose, here's one thing that helped me. When you talk about God's purpose, I want you to understand you're talking about something that is eternal, that is bigger and beyond. And so it'd be similar to me. This is a terrible state to use this analogy in, but I want to use it, and you can just use your imagination. But it'd be sort of like me saying to Pastor Jamie, Jamie, I want you to, you see the Rocky Mountains over there? I want you to go hug that mountain, right? Just think about that, right? Hug that mountain. How can I hug a mountain, right? Well, you can take all you got, and you can go get up as close to that mountain as you can, and you can open your arms wide as you can get them, right? And that would be sort of like me saying to you, I want you to embrace God's purpose, right? But here's a beautiful thing, right? Here's a beautiful thing. It's bigger. It's beyond, right? So how many of you know in order to hug a mountain, you're going to need some partners? You're going to need some people to get your hand. You know, you're going to have to join my hand, and we're going to have to do this together. We can't do this alone. And that's one of the things I really wish I could get every American Christian to understand is that you can't accomplish God's purpose all by yourself. You can accomplish the American dream by yourself. You can accomplish a lot of great things by yourself, but you can't accomplish God's purpose by yourself. It's like hugging a mountain. And so what we do as a church family is we say together we're going to join hands, we're going to join hearts, we're going to join faith, we're going to join resources, we're going to join everything together. We're going to be a community together, and we're going to hug the mountain of God's purpose. Watch this, and here's what we find out. We found out, man, the mountain of God's purpose is like Mount Everest, but here's what we find. Where are we at on the mountain? We're right here in Dunellen. We're right here in Ocala, and when we open up our eyes, and we open up our minds, we look at this little part of the mountain of God's purpose, and we see some pathways right there that it looks like maybe if we go up there, we could make some progress up that mountain. And so we say, come on, let's go up that mountain. Look right there, there's 13 acres right there. I wonder if, and then we just kind of move in that direction, and then somebody says, I don't know if we should do that. That's a little further than we imagined. And we say, that's a good sign that we're moving in the right direction. Because a mountain is humongous, but if you understand mountain climbing, you don't have to climb the whole mountain. You can get a great deal of accomplishment, and you can get a great deal of beauty and experience just by tackling whatever part of that mountain you can tackle. And I believe God's looking for some people all over Central Florida who will say, I want something that's bigger than myself, but that we can accomplish through God and in God. I want us to demonstrate something otherworldly to this county and this region so that we can be a place where heaven and earth are interacting all the time. Are you with me? Multiple generations discovering God's purpose. Moving into God's purpose. And so we've got to understand that it's bigger than what we can do on our own. But when we do it together, here's what I want to say to somebody, and I believe this is going to be liberating, right? So engaging in God's purpose is not always about accomplishing. See, you've been raised in a culture, and it's not all bad. I'm not picking on it too hard, but I want you to understand it's not kingdom culture completely. You've been raised in a culture that values accomplishing and achieving. Accomplishing and achieving. Accomplishing and achieving. And those are good things. I mean, you can really become a good person, successful. I'm all in, right? That's good. I would rather you be a person that accomplishes and achieves some things than not. Right? But when you get into real God's kingdom purpose, the emphasis isn't on accomplishing and achieving as much as it is in participating and transforming. So when God invites us into his purpose, it's not really about how much, how many, how fast, how big. It's about who are you becoming? Are you with me? So, you know, you may not be, you may not be the top salesman, but if you're the most Christ-like salesman, oh, I'm preaching good right now, right? Now, how many of you know that God wants to give you good success? I'm all in on that, right? But how many of you know we don't measure the way the world measures? How many of you know sometimes it may not look like to the world that I'm, but if I'm becoming a real image bearer of God's kingdom that's full of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control, and everybody's looking at me going, man, I wish I could live a little bit more like him. How many of you know in the kingdom metrics, I'm doing all right? Because I'm participating with and I'm being transformed. And this is what Mary does, is she opens herself up to participate with God in his purpose, and in the process, she is transformed. So then she becomes a carrier of God's purpose, and then she carries God's purpose, she cultivates God's purpose, and she delivers God's purpose. I'm preaching my message real fast for you right now. So there is a sense in which you are a little Mary. You have a little job to do. You're not going to become supernaturally impregnated today. Amen. In the physical sense of the word. And you're not going to give birth to Jesus. But what you are going to do is you're going to hear some revelation about what God's purpose is for your life in this season of your life. And then you're going to say, let it be done unto me according to your word. And when you do that, God's going to drop a seed in your spirit. He's going to drop a word of faith in your spirit. And then you're going to cultivate that word, and you're going to capture it in your heart, and you're going to pray over it and ponder it, and you're going to nurture it and cultivate it, and it's going to come to full term. And then you're going to pray it in, and you're going to birth it. And that's what happened with Grandview 11 years ago. But I want you to know, God's not finished birthing things through Grandview Church. So I'm going to give you three words that I think are really going to be liberating words for a lot of people personally, but then we're going to declare them corporately over Grandview Church. Are you with me this morning? Are you learning anything? The first word is that I want to bring a highlight and an emphasis to these words, because I believe they're kingdom values. So you say, when I'm trying to discover and discern God's purpose, here's some questions that I think you can begin to focus on. Are you ready? Yeah. Question number one is, who am I becoming? Who am I becoming? This question is going to shift us off of the questions that our culture continually asks, which is, what am I doing? What am I achieving? And what am I accomplishing? Yeah. Am I doing all right? So in your prayer time, you'll find the Holy Spirit shifting your emphasis to, who am I becoming today? Are you with me? Now, how many of you know that the good news is you never stop becoming? Amen. To as many as would receive him, to them he gave the power to become. How many of you know the first power that God gave you was power to become? Power to become something you've never been on your own. Power to become something. So that's the purpose of God, is the power to become. So God gives us power to become supernatural people, power to become Jesus people. Are you with me?
Yes.
So the next question is, and you got to think in the spirit here, okay? I know you might just work a normal job, you might just work, but I want you to think in the spirit when I say, number one is, who am I becoming? Number two is, who or what am I birthing? Wow. Or even better, who or what is God birthing through me? You see, because here's the thing. I love this. This is a fascinating oversight that we've made so often. And that is, that as Christians, we should really be in some stage or another of spiritual pregnancy. Right? And so I don't know how we've missed this all these years. I mean, I missed it too, so I'm not being hard on anybody. But, you know, the Bible constantly tells us that God wants us to be fruitful. Right? Be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful. I want you to, I've chosen you and I've ordained you to bear fruit, right? And we never really realize that the primary way, the fundamental way that humans are fruitful is by having babies. I don't know if you knew that or not, right? But that, so, it's like, an apple tree produces apples, right? How many of you know humans, we produce humans, right? That's just how it works. I know this is a little bit of biology for you this morning, but you're doing okay, right? Now, that doesn't mean if you don't produce humans that you're not fruitful, but it is the fundamental biological way that humans are fruitful. So when we translate that into the kingdom and we translate that into spiritual revelation, it means as I walk with God, I'm going to be continually going through the cycles and seasons of capturing some seed form of God's purpose and then cultivating it in my heart until it becomes full term. And then the Bible even uses the language of travail for prayer. So that we get to the place where that purpose is full term. And then the Bible tells us, Paul tells us in Romans 8, what you'll find is at a certain time in your life, the Holy Spirit will start praying in you, and it'll be prayers of travail because it's time to give birth to God's purpose. So there's a sense in which I may be, you know, in my first trimester. I know this is weird. Don't put a clip of this on YouTube. People will think I'm crazy. I might be in the second trimester spiritually or the third, or I may have just given birth, but I may be in a place of searching. And I think a lot of people right now are in a brand new season, and I'm sensing that what God is looking for at Grandview is a bunch of Marys who will say, God, I'm ready to conceive again. Lord, I know it's not normal. I know it's not conventional, but I'm here to say, let it be done unto me according to your word. Am I doing all right? So who or what am I birthing? And then the last thing that's a legacy thing, and I know this is a part of the heartbeat of this church, and Brother George, you can kind of start moving in the right direction if you want to. Well, turn the lights of the runway on so I can find it. Amen. Push those. I've been circling in the clouds. I need somebody down there at the airport to turn the lights on. Amen. I've got to find this runway here. And this is where the Lord revealed this to me. I'm just going to take just a moment. I mentioned this yesterday, but the Lord really showed me some things out of the life of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the patriarchs. And when he said, Abraham, I'm going to make you a father, right? One of the things that I believe that God's releasing a grace on this house for is to step into a corporate grace to be a place where there's a fathering spirit and a fathering heart. And that doesn't have anything to do with gender, amen? So we could say fathering and mothering. But to be a place where there's a grace to be a father to the fatherless, for the solitary to be set in families. And there's some of you who feel like, and I'm just going to declare this by the Spirit for whoever it is. I know there's some people who need to hear this, but you feel like that you have been shortchanged, or you have shortchanged God or yourself as a natural parent. But God is getting ready to bring you into a season where there's great reward and restoration, not only to your natural parenthood, but God's getting ready to let you conceive some things about your spiritual parenthood. And so there's a way in which the word to Abraham, when he said, I will make you a father, the Holy Spirit wants to make that a real promise to each and every one of us, that God's call on my life is to become a father or a mother. Are you with me? So you say, well, in John chapter 2, he says, I write to you little children, I write to you young men, and I write to you fathers. And it's not gender. He's just talking about the process of maturation. And so there's a grace on every Christian that as you mature in Christ, you take on the nature of your heavenly Father, and people start being drawn to that, and you become a father or a mother in the kingdom. Now, here's what's amazing to me about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is when we think about what their lives were. And their lives and their legacies were not characterized just by what they built or what they accomplished or what they achieved. But here's what their lives were characterized by: who they became, who they birthed, and who they blessed. And so the third prayer that I want to give you is, who is God blessing through me? Who is God birthing through me? And who am I becoming? Number one, who am I becoming? Number two, who is God birthing, or what is God birthing through me? But number three, who is God blessing through me? You see, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and even Joseph, they did whatever God called them to do. But the legacy of their life is that they became someone. They became a father. I used to be Abram, but now I'm Abraham. I used to be Jacob, but now I'm Israel. It's who they became that became the legacy of their life. And then they gave birth to whoever God told them to give birth to. So Abraham and Sarah gave birth to Isaac. Isaac and Rebekah gave birth to Jacob and Esau. And Jacob gave birth to Joseph and to Judah and to the 12 sons. So the birth, but then the beautiful thing is that whatever God graced them to birth, they made sure that before their time on earth was done, they blessed what they birthed. So I just want to say to you today that maybe you've been feeling like more of a failure than you are because you've been judging your life by the wrong metrics, and God is simply asking of you, if you'd become who I called you to be and birth what I've called you to birth and bless who I called you to bless, then your life, well done, thy good and faithful servant, because in the kingdom's metrics and in the kingdom's eyes, you're an amazing success. How many of you know that's a whole lot simpler way to live, right? Than having a big enough 401k and, you know, giving your kids everything and your kids and grandkids and all these different things, right? No. Can you become, can you birth, and can you bless? And whatever it is, it's going to move you beyond. Would you just right now, as George gets ready to start playing, would you just right now, just pray this simple prayer. I'm going to lead you in a couple of prayers here as we get ready to go. The first prayer I want you to pray is just a prayer of faith. And I want you to just say, if you can say it simple, just say, Lord, take me beyond. Ooh, you might need to pray that two or three times. Just say, Lord, take me beyond. Lord, take me beyond my comfort. Go ahead. But go ahead and make it real. Lord, take me beyond my comfort. Lord, take me beyond my culture. Lord, take me beyond my expectations. Take me beyond, Lord, people's opinions of me. Take me beyond the limitations of my past. Take me beyond, Lord, my financial capability in this season, Lord. Take me beyond the limitations that I keep being reminded of, Lord. I thank you that you are the God who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond. So, Lord, we say we're going to set our minds on your ability. We're going to say you're able. You're able. So we're saying, Lord, take us beyond. Take us beyond. I want you to stand to your feet with me, if you will. Just I was praying, getting ready for this morning, and if I'm perfectly honest with you, I knew there were some things that God wanted to say, but I had a little bit of a hard time getting clarity on exactly the path to take to get us. But here's what I believe God wants to do. You just turn your hands toward heaven in this moment. I believe that there are some people that God wants to set free today. Some of you, God wants to set free from being on the hamster wheel of achieving and accomplishing. And I just heard the Holy Spirit in my prayer time say, if you'll bring them to a place in that service, I'm going to put my finger on the hamster wheel that they've been running to keep up with. And I'm going to say, it's okay, my child. I just need you to become who I've called you to be. You don't have to keep up with the rat race of the world, and you don't have to keep up with the rat race of the culture. You're my child. You belong to me. So if you're here today and you just feel like your life's been running too fast and you've been trying to keep up with everything going on and your head's spinning and you're dizzy, God wants to move you beyond all that. God wants to move you into a whole new place of peace and a whole new place of rest. And so, Lord, we just look to you right now. Jesus, you said in Matthew 11 that if we came unto you, if we were weary and heavy laden, you would give us rest. So, Jesus, I'm asking you right now by your Spirit to meet people right there in their seat. Lord, I thank you that you can meet them right there. Lord, put your hand on their heart right now, and we speak peace and rest to every single one of them. Would you just pray this prayer? Say, Lord, I receive your rest. Just say that right now. Jesus, we receive your rest. Lord, my rest isn't really enough. My rest isn't good enough for me, but your rest is all that I need. So, Lord, my soul needs rest, and I come to you. Jesus, we receive your rest. You know, you might want to start making that a regular part of your prayer time where you just spend time with Jesus and say, Lord, today, before I get going in this crazy day I've got in front of me, I just want to say to you, I receive your rest today. I'm going to live out of your rest, the rest of Jesus. I want to minister to some people. And I feel like I may need to pray for some people. Pastor told me I could do that. I know we have a ceremony coming up, but I'm going to give you an opportunity just for me to pray. But there are people that I need to pray for that are wrestling, and you're feeling inadequate. You're feeling like a failure. You're feeling like you haven't done enough. And it's in the realm of your fruitfulness. And I believe that God wants to break all shame, guilt, and condemnation off of anybody who says, I feel like I should have been more fruitful, or I feel like I should be being more fruitful. And God's saying to you, this is a season where I'm moving you beyond your wildest imaginations into fruitfulness you've never imagined. And I feel like that there are some parents and some grandparents here. You've been too hard on yourself in the realm of your family and your fatherhood. And God wants to deliver you today. And so I'm going to ask these gatekeepers to help us. But if you want prayer to be set free from any of that today, it's not going to be long and elaborate and extended. But I want to pray a special prayer for you, because I believe that on this day, God wants to set you free and move you. He wants to thrust you into a whole new season of understanding his purpose and not living under the weight of that failure any longer. Amen. So if you'd like prayer today, guys, just get ready and let's give them direction. Just get out from your seat and begin to make your way here. If you'd like prayer this morning, pastor's going to come and give any instructions that need to be given.
If you'd like prayer, just move into these aisles right here. The gatekeepers will usher you right up front.
Amen.
Dr. J will pray for you, anoint you.
Father, we just thank you right now.
Dr. J, you want some oil?
We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do. Yeah. We need a move.
Of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah. Come on, one more time. I want to pray something over you. I just want you to turn your hands toward heaven. There's a part of the story that I didn't preach, but you'll be familiar with. And the angel said to Mary, she said, how can this be? Because I'm a virgin. And the angel said, oh, that's simple. The Holy Spirit is going to overshadow you. And the thing that is born of you will be born of God. And so I'm going to pray. I prayed for some people individually, but I want to pray. Pastor Jamie, Pastor Debbie, I'm just in standing in faith. And I'm declaring today, on this anniversary, the Holy Spirit's going to overshadow you. The Holy Spirit's going to overshadow Grandview Church. Now, we're already a place of God's presence, right? But you're coming into a season of overshadowing so that the purposes of God can be conceived for the future. Because it's in that overshadowing that we conceive the purposes of God. So come on, lift your hands toward heaven. Father, I thank you right now that you're overshadowing this people. You're overshadowing this church. We thank you, Lord, that you're not anywhere near finished with us. And Lord, we say in the overshadowing cloud of your presence, we say like Mary, let it be done unto us according to your word. So on the count of three, I want you to pray that with me. I'm going to count to three so you'll know when to do it, but we're going to pray, let it be done unto us according to your word. Are you ready, Grandview? Come on, let's pray that corporately. One, two, three. Let it be done unto us according to your word. Amen. Come on, give him praise. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. God.
Isn't he something? The executive teaching pastor of the Gate Church, Oklahoma City, Dr. Jay Pike. Thank you, my brother. Thank you, my brother. Y'all be seated just for a second. I'm going to give us some instructions because we've been so blessed this morning. We've got one more thing to do, and then we're going to eat like kings. But we're going to do something so spiritually important that we're going to set our teens up for success. We're going to prophesy over them. We're going to consecrate that teen zone unto them. So this is what we're going to do. Debbie and I and Dr. J and the Hutchinsons are going to walk out to the teen zone. It's a construction zone, so you got to be kind of careful. You know, don't step on any of the forming or you know, all that kind of stuff. Watch where you step, or you just take care as you're walking out there. It's a construction zone. We won't be able to go into the building today because there's nails and this and that, and I don't want anybody to get injured. But we want to go out there, and we're going to cut the ribbon. Dr. J is going to prophesy over that. The leadership, I would love for the leadership, Talbots, Julian's, everybody, join us on the platform. And then I would love for our teens to join us on the platform as well. And because I want you to hear what's being prophesied and consecrated unto y'all's ministry. And now if you do, it's a little bit of a walk. It's probably 200-300 feet walk out there. If you'd rather stay and sit, we've got seating on the Gathering Place Plaza out here. You can sit and wait for lunch. But if you can walk with us, let's do it. Like the children of Israel going across the Jordan, let's walk out there and claim this promised land. Amen? So,